Talking further about fertility in an OTIL operation, NDSU has done a replicated research over the last 8 or 10 years that verifies that you can take a nitrogen credit from the additional organic matter that you've been able to build your soil up. So, and I hear a whole bunch of different numbers and a whole bunch of ways to figure it out, but in my mind, one of the figures I use is there's approximately 20 pounds of available nitrogen per percent of organic matter that you can fairly well count on for most crop rotations. So let's just pick corn. If you have an organic matter of 2.5, that would be, the math would say that you should have about 50 pounds of mineralization that you can credit yourself, okay? If you have an organic matter of 5, then you should be able to credit yourself 100 pounds of nitrogen that you can mineralize in a year's time. What if you have 7? All of a sudden it's 140 pounds of nitrogen that you can credit yourself that you don't have to apply. So one of the things I've learned from some of the work that NDSU has done, Dr. Dave Franson, he did some of the work he was doing on my farm where I was carrying 6 and 7% organic matter where he was doing the testing. A 40 to 60 pound application of nitrogen was all that was required to meet my yield goals. I was over fertilizing because I just didn't dare cut back to that low until I saw it firsthand and saw the yield results over the 3 or 4 years that he did the work across the state, but also on my farm. So I've cut my nitrogen way back. Talking about cover crops and fertility and how they may help you, and there's really multiple ways. It's pretty hard to quantify that other than just using the biomass production from that cover crop. But one of the ways that we know that cover crops can help recycle nutrients. Let's just take a legume, all right? They can actually pull nitrogen because of their ability to fix nitrogen using that symbiotic relationship with the bacteria on their roots, right? So that's awesome, right? The legumes that we're using in the cover crops, especially peas, don't root very deep, okay? Throwing in some brassicas in that group, and when I say brassicas, turnip, radish, rapeseed, those are all in the brassica family. And what they are is a tap-rooted, fast-growing, cold-tolerant plant that allows growth late into the fall. But their claim to fame is their ability to root deep into the soil, 4-5 feet in like 2.5 months. And they're able to go down and reclaim nitrogen that has escaped the root systems of most of our annual crops. Most of our annual crops do not root that deep. In fact, very few of them do. They can potentially go down and scavenge some of that nitrogen, bring it back up in the form of biomass closer to the surface where the next year's crop can utilize it. So it's a very important aspect of cover cropping and the important reason to have multiple species in there to do different work for you. Well, my application of compost, I'm hoping actually makes my soil more resilient to drought versus wet. Again, it's building organic matter, building the base level of fertility in my soil. I just really believe in manures and especially composts to keep and feed that biology so you keep a healthy soil. Biology, having the organic component in your soil and then having the live roots, the combination of that with the live roots with the cover is just really great for the biology in the soil. And that's where all the nutrient cycling happens, is with that biology. So you can make more nutrition become available without the use of commercial fertilizers by just having those two components.